drinks and drinks
his blood, drink
and feed his righteous sentence.
Color Guard, present the colors. Audience, please stand and rise. Larry, would you please come forward and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag?
All military personnel, in uniform or without uniform, you do now have the right to render a hand salute. Join me in the pledge, please.
Thank you, Tomball. Please, color guard. Most of the members of that honor guard are former military. You may seat. I'd like to introduce the Honorable Mayor of Tomball, Mayor Gretchen Fagan, who has a proclamation for our audience today. Mayor?
All right. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
I can hear me. Good afternoon, everyone. And first of all, I would just like to say, on behalf of our City Council, thank you very much for your service. We all know that we wouldn't be here without those men and women in uniform. And so I'd just like to say thank you. And then we have a proclamation.
Would you like to come up here and get this?
Sure.
All right, it says, Office of the Mayor, Tomball, Texas Proclamation. Whereas it's long been a custom in the United States of America to commemorate November 11th, the anniversary of the ending of World War I by paying tribute to our heroes of that tragic struggle and by redirecting ourselves to the cause of peace. And whereas on June 4th, 1928, Congress passed Resolution 44, Stat. 1962, calling for the observance of November 11th with appropriate ceremonies, and later provided in an act approved May 13, 1938, 52 Stat. 351. The 11th day of November should be a legal holiday and known as Armistice Day. And whereas, in order to magnify the significance of that commemoration, in order that a grateful nation might pay appropriate homage to the veterans of all its wars who contributed so much to the preservation of this nation, Congress further, by act approved June 1st, 1954, changed the name of the holiday to Veterans Day. And whereas the theme of Veterans Day 2021 is centered on the centennial commemoration of the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, located at Arlington National Cemetery, the tomb was initially dedicated by the Army on Armistice Day, November 11th, 1921, with the burial of an unknown service member from World War I. And whereas over the past century, additional unknowns have been buried at the tomb, and the site has become the people's memorial that inspires reflection on service, valor, sacrifice, mourning, and whereas citizens of the city of Tomball, the United States of America, take great pride and pleasure in celebrating Veterans Day, honoring and solemnly remembering sacrifices all those who fought so valiantly on the seas, in the air, and on foreign soils to preserve the heritage of our freedom and reconsecrating ourselves to the task of promoting enduring peace so that their efforts will not be in vain. Now, therefore, I, Gretchen Fagan, Mayor of the City of Tomball, Texas, on behalf of our City Council, and in cooperation with members of the Christian Business Luncheon Association, do hereby proclaim November 11th, 2021, as Tomball Veterans Day.
Thank you very much.
There you go.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I take it home and hang it on my wall? Probably not. At this time, we would like to recognize the different branches of the military. When you hear your service song, please stand and be recognized by our audience. Our music is provided by Paul Acott. Army! Coast Guard, any Coast Guard? All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. I don't know the name of the flautist.
Rex Munchen.
Thank you, you and Paula. I'm sorry. I should have had this up all the time. There is not one for Space Force yet, nor have we found
a flag for the Space Force yet, but on your tables are a display of all the service branches. I'd like to call your attention to the memorial on the piano. All the rest of the memorials are somewhat joyful. That one on the piano is not. There are 22 flags on that memorial, and that's how many servicemen we lose every day to suicide. I don't know how frequently they change that statistic, but as much as I know, that was the statistic, unfortunately, in 2019. I'd like to now take some time to introduce my friend and co-founder. Well, actually, he was the founder of a small consulting business that we had for a period of time from 1998 to 2014. And we hope to discuss how our faith prepared us for the conflict in Vietnam. With that, I'd like to have Ken Jayne, Colonel retired, come to the podium.
Thank you, Paul. Okay, I am not going to give you a vision test or a reading test. Let me summarize my bio real fast. Born in Jackson, Mississippi. 28 moves later, here I am in Houston, Texas. My next move, Houston National Cemetery. I did serve in basically every organization from detachment to the organization of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. To my surprise, when I was looking for a recording, I found that many denominations have taken this hymnal, this hymn, out of their hymnals because it is too military. And that reminds me of what happened about 10 years after what we'll talk about in Vietnam, when I commanded a battalion in Germany. And we had allowed a civilian missionary into our coffee house until I happened to read some of the pamphlets that he was passing out. They asked the question, can a Christian be a soldier? And he had a different answer than I did. I told him, I said, you can't do that. What you do outside the gates, your business. What you do inside the gates, my business. You're banned from this concern. He says, you can't do that. I says, tell that to the MPs as they escort you out. And there's more and more of that now. It is getting to the point, you can't be a Christian to some people and be in the military, and you can't be a soldier and be a Christian. That is wrong. Amen. When I went to Vietnam, my mother gave me a laminated card with Psalms 91. This particular verse is the one that really struck a chord with me. And as you'll see on some of the things that I will talk about, there were times when, in fact, some fell to the left of me and some fell to the right of me. But I was okay. I was part of the advance party. I had 30 days in combat before the division got there. I flew over the C-130, thought that flight would never end. The rest of the division came over by ship. These are helicopters and crews on the Croton. We were offloading them to fly into An K, which is where the division was located, a place called the golf course. I'll talk about more later. What we did not know, I was putting people in a helicopter, no armor, no machine guns, mattresses and fans the Navy had given us to take up there. Hopefully we could use it sometime. They got up there to find out that the 173rd Airborne that was supposed to be providing security for the first cab, in fact, had a problem themselves. And we were committed to combat as soon as they got there. So these young men got up there, unloaded the helicopters. They didn't have machine guns. The crew chiefs and gunners used M16s. They were committed right away. You never know. Back to you, Paul.
Thank you, Ken. You can't imagine how long I had to hold my stomach in to take this photo. This was the aircraft that I flew in Vietnam. It's a carrier-based anti-submarine warfare airplane. And that's me in front of the aircraft. The first tour I was there for 6 months in 1968 to the latter part of 68. We attempted to fly some combat missions, but the aircraft was not equipped for that. What it could do was fly very, very low to the ground. And we had some capability ordnance-wise to destroy some of the transportation routes, but not much else. But we were very, very susceptible to fire because we had no armament, we had no self-sealing tanks. So for the latter part of that cruise, we were assigned Operation Market Time, where we would interdict shipping that was going to other ports in North and South Vietnam to stop the resupply of military supplies. After that tour ended, I came back home for about 6 months to be greeted by my wife with this young thing that I didn't recognize, who happened to be my daughter, who had grown up quite a bit in 9 months, as you can imagine. I then was assigned to the Bennington, another CVS, flying similar type missions. But one of them that was most interesting to me was we would do gunfire spotting for the USS New Jersey battleship. And this is what the shots looked like coming out of a 16-inch gun. And the first time I flew the gun line over the New Jersey, the gun went off and I jerked on the control stick and gained 200 feet of altitude pretty quick. But fortunately, I think it did a lot of damage because the 16-inch guns had a larger range, a longer range than the armament that the Vietnamese were trying to throw on the ships. Now, I'm going to return it back to Ken in a Huntley-Brinkley style. Ken, over to you.
I suspect some of you younger folks are going to say, Huntley Brinkley, who are they? How many don't know who Huntley Brinkley were? How many do know who Huntley Brinkley was? Okay. I guess we got an older crowd than I thought. All right. I mentioned the golf course. Some of the division other than me, I flew over to basically was flying combat for 30 days. Some wound up at the new position in An K, and it was basically in the middle of the jungle. The general in charge says, fellas, I want you to think shovel and that axe as a golf club. He says, I want you to make this thing into a golf course. And so you can see them up there. That's what they did. We cleared it with everything from privates to warrant officers and captains. And this is what it wound up with, the helicopters in more or less a cleared area. Our logistical tail had not caught up with us. What we had to eat was either C rations, which was little cans, or B rations, which was big cans. And so when we got a chance to get some fresh meat, literally one of the gunners shot some kind of antelope and they brought it back and barbecued it. A little tough, but it was a change. Mail call is always an important morale factor. 90% of the time, it's good news. I won't go into Dear John's. I mentioned God taking care of me. When we left Fort Benning, thousands of soldiers were leaving at the same time. So people that had houses, it was basically a buyer's market. Nobody was there really to buy them. And so my wife's from Germany, and she was going to take the two boys back to be with their German grandparents. But we're worried, what do we do about the house? How do we sell it? Can we rent it? The man in the middle there is Colonel Keller. Colonel Keller lived on post. In those days, when you were deployed, if you were living on post, you moved off post. You couldn't stay on post. So he needed a place for his family to stay. God worked it out. He had a house to stay in. I had a house that was rented. This is kind of how we lived after the first couple of months. The first ones that went there were living in pup tents. This is basically called a GP medium, general purpose medium tent. We kind of fixed it up, little quasi rooms there with the bamboo curtains. That gun you see up there is an SKS, captain for the Chi-Com. Play me, you'll talk about this a little later. Despite being in combat, one of the people that always was with the troops was Martha Ray, a great person, a great entertainer. Troops were there, she was there. Years later, during the Desert War, as a full colonel, she was there, and they were overrun in one of the hospitals there. She went in and started to work. Some captain doctor came up and says, "Please get out of here. We're working, you know." She says, "Young man, I'm a full colonel, Army Nurse Corps. Captain, I will be in here." He says, "Yes, ma'am." We couldn't give everybody the Sabbath off, Sunday off. But we did try to give people some time off. At least maybe a day off during the week where we were not planning on calling them on a mission. They could get a little recreation, they could go downtown. If they could get maybe 2 days off, they might get a flight down to Saigon and then see the big city. Even though you have a helicopter, you really need to fall in on the people you support. And so whenever the infantry was operating in an area of operations, we usually set up a satellite base. This is one in Happy Valley. While we were there, we got boarded. God took care of us, nobody got hurt. However, one of those things where God really took care of me, on one particular operation, we went into what was called a cold LZ, which means that the intelligence people will tell you there's not going to be any opposition there. That's good news. The bad news is they don't prep it. You don't fire artillery, TAC air, rockets. So you're going in basically unsupported. We got there, the machine gun on my side jammed. The purpose of the machine gun and the helicopters is to suppress the enemy, keep their heads down so they can't fire at you. When mine jammed, a little guy popped up from a creek bed and put 7 rounds from an AK-47 in the little plexiglass window right behind my head. That got my attention. I grabbed the first gun I could get, which was a backup pistol in my flak vest. I had 5 rounds in it. It was bang, 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 click, click, click. He went down. And I called the gunship in to get the rest of his friends. I wanted to be sure to get him down before he corrected his aim. Again, God taking care of me. This top slide is an ambush by the VC of the Army. It's the Army of Vietnam. They made an attack against the bottom slide, which was a special forces camp at Play Me. The Arvin column was there to rescue them. It was an ambush. They got wiped out. That's what put us up in there. And so we moved our operations in from Anquet up to Pleiku to Camp Holloway. How many of you saw the movie We Were Soldiers? Anybody? Okay. This is LZ X-Ray, Colonel Hal Moore. Joe Galloway. Hal Moore passed away about 3 years ago. Joe Galloway just passed away recently. Joe was a journalist that made a mistake asking to go along on the insertion in the X-ray. He wound up fighting, actually got the Bronze Star. They had 3 days of intense combat there. Early on in the country, the medevac battalion commander took a round right here, killed him instantly. They put a replacement commander in. The unit never recovered. Most of the medevacs, great records. That particular unit did not. As a result, when Bruce Crandall, who was the air mission commander, told the medevacs to go in with him, they turned off, aborted, would not land, said it was too hot. We continued to do medevacs with the slicks. That's just the regular Hueys, not gunships, not medevac. That night, back at Holloway, in the bar they had set up there, the med battalion commander came up to Bruce and chewed him out and says, "You put my pilots at risk." Bruce says, "Your pilots disobeyed my order. People died because they did not go in there." The guy threatened him. In the movie, Bruce pulled out a 38. Real world, Bruce cold cocked him and sent him through the wall of the bar. You don't mess with our troops. If you got a mission, you do it. If you don't do it, you pay the price. X-ray, over 3 days, they were supported. Reinforcements came in. A B-52 raid was scheduled. They had to get out of Dodge at least 2 miles away before the B-52 strike came in. So they marched to what would be called LZ Albany. Captain Weitzel, who was one of our pilots that was a liaison to the 2nd of the 7th Battalion, and Captain Spires, who was the operations officer, found a small LZ, thinking it would be used for to extract them when they got up there. Didn't work that way. This is the B-52 mission. If you see that real tall column of smoke, that tells you that one of those bombs had a secondary explosion. They hit ammunition. Probably a whole big cake of it. And when those things went off, it not only shook the ground, if you were flying, you could feel the shock wave. LZ Albany, you don't hear much about LZ Albany. The reason is LZ X-ray and the movie got the publicity. Actually, in Albany, more than twice as many people were killed. 180 Americans were killed in LZ Albany. More VC, North Vietnamese, were killed than any place else. The Americans were marching. The 66th Pavin, or North Vietnamese Regiment, had orders to march out at the same time, going to the same place. They were having lunch when the 2nd and the 7th wandered into them. They immediately deployed. They cut the column of the 2nd and the 7th in half, and it was hand-to-hand fighting. People were fighting with entrenching tools, knives. You didn't have room sometimes to even deploy your M16. You couldn't call in artillery or attack air because everybody was all mixed up. All that day, medevacs and resupply missions into the night. The last one around 11 p.m. Finally, about 2 a.m., a radio call for help comes in the operations. The operations officer goes to Colonel Bill, Major Bennett, Will Bennett, my commander. Says, sir, there's wounded that if they get out, will live. If they don't, they'll die. And they need ammunition. He says, I'll take my ship and go find me another crew. I always flew with Will. They didn't go far. Will and I went. We got up there. We were going to land at the T. They said, negative, negative, negative. The T's not in our hands. The T belongs to the enemy. Look around and see if you see a red flashlight flashing. We said, yeah, we see one. Said, how many times is it flashing? We said, three. They says, that's it. Come on in on it. So they landed to a red flashlight. And we had no lights turned on the helicopter. No navigation lights, all dark. Trying to make ourselves as little a target as possible. Landed there, got the troops out. The 20-minute light came on while we were there. It was a 15-minute flight back. We got back to the medevac pad. We didn't have enough fuel to hover to the fueling point. We had to shut down, have the fuel truck come to us. While we were waiting, there were about 16 wounded soldiers lying around the medevac pad. They would get men as fast as they could, but they just couldn't handle that many at once. Command Sergeant Major Scott was walking around to his troops, putting his arms around and saying, son, we got it made. We're here now. We're going to get taken care of. And I looked at him, and he had holes here, 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 and coming out the back. How he was stood up and walked around, I do not know. But he told me, he says, when we heard those helicopters, it sounded like the wings of angels flapping. That got picked up by a newspaper, and we really felt good about it. And that's one thing. Once you do a mission like that, you can never turn a voluntary mission down. You just can't do it. This is short final into a hot LZ. You can see the smoke. I'm not sure whether that's artillery or rockets. We had to be at the release point, the leadership, within 5 seconds. He did a time hack to the second. The reason it was so tight, if you got there too early, you got shot down by the enemy. If you got there too late, you're likely to be shot down by your own people. This is a painting, but it is a pretty good picture of what a typical landing in an LZ looks like. That is the correct helicopters. That is the crest of the 229th Assault Helicopter Battalion. I mentioned suppressive fire. Two things. If you notice the machine guns, if you'll notice the machine guns, they are firing. And the reason for that is to keep the bad guys from shooting back at you. And you see the troops, they're ready to jump off. Now, when they first hit the ground, it depends upon how high those machine guns are firing, whether they stay down low or whether they get up and run. You gotta know what you're doing. If you run at the wrong time, get hit by your own people. If you get down, stay down too low, then you haven't got the advantage of a suppressive fire. This is what's called a lager. A lager area basically is a waiting area. You're waiting commitment into another mission. The radio there is a battery pilot radio, so you don't run the battery down on the helicopter. You obviously don't want to run the engine. This particular one was okay. We were in another lager area. Will Bennett and his ship, me and our ship, and we were taken under fire. I happened to be between my ship and his when the firing started. Fortunately, there was a foxhole next to me. I dropped into the foxhole till the firing stopped, went over. Will's ship was shot up. We had a pilot wounded in the hip, the femur. Took him into our ship, flew back to the medevac pad, landed at the medevac pad. They came in, took him in. There are two pins on the back of that seat that cause the seat belt to go down so you can pull a pilot out in case a pilot is wounded. All of a sudden, the seat back goes down. I said, what in the heck are you doing? They said, sir, we're taking you out. I said, the heck you are, I'm not wounded. They said, the heck you aren't, you are wounded. Look at the front of your uniform. I looked down, they were right, it was full of blood. But it was one of those million-dollar wounds. It just barely grazed my cheek. I didn't even feel it. And he says, we're going to take you out. And I says, no, you're not. I says, I've got a ship back up here. I've got people waiting for us. Forget about it. We're okay. It never gave me any problems. But once a year, that scar would come back. It hasn't for years. But God was taking care of me. If it had been a little farther, who knows? This is just some of the stuff that happened. A lot of times we went into villages and you check. Sometimes you'd find these little guys there. They wound up being prisoners. They also took the women and children out of some of these villages. And I don't see any adults here. My guess is these were probably the women and children from VC, but I don't know that, but that's a pretty good guess. We knew pretty well where the Arvin had people. Montagnards. Montagnards are like Indians. They were there before the Vietnamese came in. And they were very much discriminated against by the Vietnamese. They were friendly, they were small in stature, tough as the dickens. You don't want to mess with one. They're good friends, but don't get in the wrong side. The upper left is just women and children. The lower left is a typical Montagnard village. You can see the defenses, the tribal house in the center. The lower right, a water buffalo got hit. Artillery, bomb, don't know. But they had to salvage the meat. That's a lot of meat for the village. So they're carrying it back. And then kids are kids, whether they're 20-something years old as the soldier there, or 10 years old as the little kids down there. I had a reel-to-reel tape recorder that never heard their voices, so I let them listen to the voices. They got a real good kick out of it. Redeploying to Tuiwa. Again, being close to the infantry. Flew down over the South China Sea, flying over the water, wondering, you know, wonder what happens if the engine quits. Maybe I can land on that little beach down there. Got all the way down on short final. Sure enough, I got a compressor stall, my engine quit. I made an auto rotation into my landing site. This is kind of what it looked like on the beach. We had a windstorm hit just before we landed, or just after, I don't remember. But they had put up all the tents before we got there. They all blew down. The big bladders you see are 10,000 gallon fuel bladders. Also the ammo, that's called a FARP. Forward area refueling point. Down below is the facilities. The left is the shower. If you're lucky, you put an immersion heater in to make the water a little hot. If not, it's cold. The latrine is basically two holes over half of a 55-gallon. They put either JP4 or diesel in and light it. That's the way they take care of that. After that, in Tuiwa, we went up on the last operation I was on. We went in, took the infantry in down the valley. Wasn't bad, wasn't hot, but they made us logger all day waiting. Just before dark, they said, okay, we fired from the New Jersey. Those big balls of fire you saw coming from the New Jersey, that's what was supporting us. You could actually see the rounds go through the air. TAC air, 8-inch, 155s, 105s, rockets. Everything on that plateau. Finally, I says, okay, guys, it's clear, go in. We went in, we landed into a U. The little guys had spider holes. they had gotten down into little holes, and we're on short final, they popped up and caught us in a crossfire. My wingman exploded in midair. I lost a crew of 4-7 infantry. I took the rest of the flight after we downloaded the infantry. Went back down into the area we had dropped off before. Even though it was dark, I knew how to get in there. We take a flashlight and shine it up through the holes in the helicopter and see what it hits. If it hits some control arms, you got to shut down. You can't fly. It didn't. So we flew back to the FARP. We got to the FARP, start refueling. The crew chief comes, cut it, cut it, cut it. I says, what do you mean, what's wrong? He says, shut it down, sir. His fuel's going all over the place. We took rounds too. The difference is, God took care of us. Our rounds went through fuel. Fuel in and by itself won't burn. Fuel with air explodes. The other ship, the rounds went through between the top of the fuel and the top of the fuel tank and the fuel air mixture. That was about 2 weeks before I was scheduled to go home. I wasn't sure whether I was going to make it or not. So my boss sent me back to Anquet, where the new commander had come in and said, your job is to orient him, which I did. And then came home. Back to you, Paul.
Thank you, Ken. Of course, my trip in Vietnam was not nearly as exciting, but I was thankful that Ken was there to take care of those of us who got to go to sleep in our staterooms on the aircraft carrier, knowing who our roomies were, not like he had to. This is a picture of me in my last tour of duty. I was a flight deck officer on the USS Coral Sea. Don't let that picture deceive you. I had to borrow my wife's mascara to make that mustache look like anything. And of course, I'm a lot heavier than I was then. But this is the picture of the Coral Sea, and she was the lead carrier. And before I go any further, if you have to leave, you're not going to hurt Ken and I's feelings. But we thought Ken's message was so powerful that you needed to hear it all. So I'll try to wrap this up in the next 5 or 7 minutes. Anyhow, Coral Sea was the lead carrier. There were three carriers on Yankee Station, each assigned a 120-degree quadrant. And we were in the forward quadrant when President Nixon declared that he was going to mine Haiphong Harbor and it was going to expedite the bombing of major ports and cities in the Hanoi and Hainan region. And that's the purpose of this particular mission. Here's some of the mining operations that went on in Vietnam. Actually, there were over 300,000 mines that were placed in during the Vietnam conflict. Most were placed in rivers and tributaries and didn't have a significant impact on the replenishment of the North Vietnamese at that particular time. So when the decision was made by President Nixon, he made that decision, I think, in the 10th of May. We were 6,000 miles away when we got the word. I was a flight deck officer, and we had control of all the elevators. And I should have had some kind of hint that something else was going on when they asked us to move all of our crash equipment that we had on the flight deck off the weapons elevators. And so the night duty people called me up. I said, what are they bringing up? And they said, sir, it looks like mines to us. We were not scheduled, as far as any of us knew, to conduct a mining operation. But the next morning, the instructions from the White House and the Pentagon was the minute that President Nixon announces we are in the process of mining Haiphong Harbor, an announcement he made on national television at 9 o'clock. The first mine went into Haiphong Harbor at 9:01. There were 5 A-6s and 5 A-7s that conducted all of the mining operation during that period of time. There were 36 foreign flagged vessels in the unloading area in Haiphong Harbor. Only one British, and as you see from the slide, four Soviet ships left before the mines were activated. There was a 72-hour delay to allow those ships that were in port to leave if they chose to do so. I guess they did such a wonderful job in seeding the harbor that the ships that were there were afraid. Either that or they didn't trust that we hadn't activated the mines, but only five of them left before they were activated. We feel strongly that the mining operation connected also with extensive strategic bombing in the north in the Hanoi and Haiphong area contributed significantly to bringing the Viet Cong and the North Vietnamese and the Chinese to the peace talk in Paris. And that Paris peace agreement was finally signed January 27th in 1973. It's kind of an interesting aside. You see that ship there, it's a minesweeper, MSO-446, which was commanded by a classmate of mine from the Naval Academy. A strange coincidence, and don't tell me God doesn't participate in coincidences. I was stationed for my first class midshipman cruise on the USS Fortify. I've spoken with the captain. This is a picture of Haiphong Harbor that we're talking about. And at the top you see with the strategic bombing done, Ken showed you the B-52 strikes that he witnessed. These were the explosions that decimated the port of Haiphong and Hanoi during that period of time. The cleanup of the mines is kind of interesting. There are four minesweeper oceans which Fortify, the previous slide showed. On the 27th of January, the Paris Peace Accord was signed. On the 6th of February, the minesweepers commenced sweeping. They swept for 21 days. The North Vietnamese ceased releasing the POWs, which was part of the Paris peace talks. So a minesweeping operation ceased. They resumed about, 2 months later. The whole operation to clear the mines took 6 months. The Navy had proposed, the sad part about this scenario is the Joint Chiefs of Staff in November of 1965 had proposed a mining operation to LBJ. I know he's a Texan, and I know a lot of people love him, but he cursed them out, kicked them out of his office, and the Navy never approached mine seeding for several years after that. Sadly, during that period of time, we incurred an additional 47,200 combat deaths and military action related, and 10,270 military and related combat casualties. This was really a helicopter war.
There's anybody here today who doesn't thrill to the sound of those blades. That familiar wop 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 is the soundtrack of our war, the lullaby of our younger days. To someone who spent his time in Nam with the grunts, I've got to tell you that noise was always a great comfort. It meant someone was coming to help. Someone was coming to get our wounded. Someone was coming to bring us water and ammo. Someone was coming to take our dead brothers home. And eventually, someone was coming to give us a ride out of hell. Even today when I hear it, I stop, catch my breath, and think back to those days. I love you guys as only an infantryman can. No matter how bad things were, if we called, you came. Down through the green tracers and other visible signs of a real bad day, off to a real bad start. To us, you seemed beyond brave and fearless, that you would come to us in the middle of battle, in those flimsy, thin-skinned crates, and in the storm of fire, you would sit up there behind that thin plexiglass, seeming so patient and so calm and so vulnerable, waiting for the offloading and the onloading. We thought you were God's own lunatics, and we loved you, still do. We're the fortunate ones. We survived when so many better men gave up their precious lives for us. We owe them a sacred debt to live each day to its fullest. What they're saying when you listen hard enough is this: we're at peace, and so should you be, and so should you be.
Defer to questions and answers in case anybody has to leave, but we will be around to answer. At this point in time, just another statistics to throw at you. The average life expectancy of an attacked helicopter pilot during Vietnam was 16 to 30 days. That's why we lost almost 5,000. How can you help our veterans? Twice a year there are services at the Veterans Cemetery here. The first is the planting of the flags, and the second is the laying of the Christmas wreaths, which is going to happen in December, early December. I'd suggest that you find out more information by going to the info page of the VA Cemetery here. It's a very moving experience, and I would encourage you, if you have children and grandchildren, that you allow them to accompany you to see what the military and the veterans have sacrificed for the freedoms that we presently enjoy.